Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. Syria has been a battleground in which various conflicts and forces have intertwined. Along with the civil war, there's the age-old confrontation between Turkey and the Kurdish organizations fighting for aspired independence, global and regional power struggles for dominance, and jihadist groups vying to assert Islamic control over territory as a launching pad for further expansion. The latest example, of course, was the successful American operation that brought about the demise of the self-proclaimed Caliph of Daesh, Bakr al-Baghdadi. To evaluate the state of affairs and implications of the latest developments in Israel's northern neighbor Syria, we're joined here in the studio by Mr. Yoni Ben Menachem, who is a journalist and Middle East expert. Welcome. I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir Oren, and Dr. Rhode, who is a former Pentagon official who served as the U.S. Secretary of Defense's advisor on Islamic affairs. Welcome. Mr. Oren, give us a broader understanding of everything that's taking place in our northern neighbor, Syria.
So in short order, we had over the last couple of weeks two surprising developments. The first was the American decision to pull out some two dozen or so special forces officers and trainers from the Kurdish area, the Syrian Democratic Forces area, adjacent to the Turkish forces, thereby enabling the Turks to go further south. President Trump said that this was only some 7 or 8 miles and only 3 days of battle, without which the Kurds wouldn't have moved. And then while the region was trying to get accustomed to this new reality, news came of the very skillful raid by U.S. Special Forces against the compound in which Bakr al-Baghdadi was hiding, resulting in his death and the destruction of this compound. A lot of intelligence material was gained. Now, President Trump depicted this operation in a certain light. Some other officials had more limited descriptions of this raid. For instance, the top Pentagon official said that al-Baghdadi was, at the time of his death, only the inspirational leader of Daesh, because there is really no chain of command. No one has been in control of the group. Obviously, last March, the Americans have announced that the Daesh is 100% through. So these are two very important developments, and we will have to see whether, following that, what happens between the Turks and the Syrians and the Russians and both of them and the Iranians thrown in changes in a material way the fate of Syria.
And during this panel, we'll try and touch base on all the variables of this challenge. Mr. Ben Menachem, I'd like to try and understand to what degree was this assassination and operation, as successful as it was, really impacting on a regional scale and in the fight against terror. Of course, once you cut the head of a snake, the rest of the snake continues to wiggle around quite violently. Are we going to see this kind of situation in which the Islamic State's militants and terrorists around the world will try to somehow provide certain achievements, so to speak, in their perception with regard to terror attacks that will harm the Western world or others?
Yes, definitely. First of all, it's a snake that will grow a new head. So once you cut off the head of the snake, which was Bakr al-Baghdadi, it didn't finish with ISIS. It's a serious blow to the organization, but when you kill the leader, you didn't kill the ideology. And there are still thousands of fighters of ISIS in Syria, in Iraq, and there are sleepers in different places of the world. There are branches in the north of Sinai, in different places in Asia and Africa. And I think just today, The Turks announced that they arrested three ISIS activists who were planning to make a revenge attack on the killing of Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. So I think there is alert all over Europe and other places in the world to face the possibility of terror attacks in revenge for the killing of Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. Basically, I think that the new leader of ISIS, the successor of Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, whoever it will be, there is a name, but I think that President Trump said just a while ago that Americans also killed the successor, the potential successor of al-Baghdadi. He didn't give the name of the person, but the person that was supposed to succeed him was Abdallah Kirdash or Kardash, and he was a senior figure in ISIS. He met with Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi 16 years ago when they were together in prison in Iraq, American prison. And he's very tough and cruel. And some people say that even more cruel than Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. So we will try now to make a new image for the for ISIS. The problem is that we don't know what will happen with the other jihadist organizations, because there's a rivalry between ISIS and Al-Qaeda, and between ISIS and Huras al-Din. It's another jihadist organization. And also we don't know what will happen with the branches. What will, for instance, let's take something which is close to us, like the north of Sinai. We're talking about Wilayat Sinai, the ISIS branch in the north of Sinai, that they were called Ansar Bet El Maqdis, or independent. They were also attacking Israel every once in a while with rockets. And then after they joined ISIS, they only concentrated on the Egyptian army. So we don't know what will happen. Will they stay loyal to ISIS after Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi was killed? Will they be independent? Will they join Al-Qaeda? Will they start making attacks towards Israel again in order to gain some popularity? So there are many questions. We don't know what will happen with Boko Haram, what will happen with the Shabab.
Many questions
in Somalia.
Indeed.
Yeah, so it's very vague. The picture is still very vague.
Dr. Rhode, you've served as an advisor to numerous secretaries of defense over the course of more than 20 years in the United States and the Pentagon, specifically on the Islamic affairs. Obviously, killing Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi is a great achievement for the United States, but it doesn't deal with the root. And the root is Islamic ideology that battles for world dominance, not just regional dominance. It's not only about Iraq and the Levant, as Daesh is specifically in Arabic, Dawlat Islam bil Iraq wa bilad al-Sham, the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant. There is a lot more to it. What would you, as a senior advisor to a secretary, tell right now Mark Esper with regard to the next stage ahead?
Well, let's say there are two things. And number one, you have a picture here behind you of Erdogan. Erdogan has been extremely helpful to ISIS, to Daesh, over the years. He's, let's say, looked the other way. Well, they have go in and out of Turkey, and for that matter, his own daughter and son-in-law were making a lot of money off of Daesh. Now, all of a sudden, and this is key, in the Middle East, power matters. Are you willing to show who's boss? What Trump did yesterday, or a few days ago, was, in essence, show them who's boss. And look at what Erdogan has been saying and doing in the meantime. All of a sudden, he's bowing down to President Trump because he showed that he's the boss. No, but how at the same time is he working with Erdogan? So what everybody says doesn't matter. But I would argue one other thing. Now we've gotten al-Baghdadi. That's good. And as you know, all the gentlemen here have said, there a new one is going to happen. This is, Jonathan, as you just said, the battle of Islam versus the world. This is an unending battle. You can look at this in Sharia, in Muslim holy law, and in the Quran. This is forever until the whole world becomes Muslim. There is no such thing as a permanent peace in Islamic culture. What there is temporary thing. You're, Jonathan, you're strong, a Harold, I'm weak. I'll make a temporary agreement with you until I can be strong. Then I'm going to get you. I could write anything in an agreement. Agreements don't matter. If you remember in Oslo, at the Oslo agreement, Arafat signed whatever at the White House. And 2 weeks later, he's in South Africa calling for jihad, jihad, jihad. What is jihad? I did this basically as an interim step. So, but eventually, when I'm stronger, I'll use every opportunity, every tool at my disposal to help advance Islam. So all these agreements and all these don't matter. What matters is strength, that you show who's boss. And the only way, and I've written a book on this, the only way that you're going to have any type of change in Islam is if they suffer worldwide a huge catastrophic defeat, and then there are people who already know that Islam is doomed who are Muslims. They can reinterpret their sources and find ways to get along with the non-Muslim world. It's all there.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Oren, I'd like to focus on the various developments that led Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi to go to the Islamist-infested territory of northwestern Syria, called the governorate of Idlib. President Bashar al-Assad, his forces made various agreements with various troops in different locations across Syria in order to transfer the jihadist forces, whether it was Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis or Tahrir al-Sham or the different organizations operating there, primarily Daesh, the Islamic State, and al-Qaeda-backed or linked groups, to move to this region. And just several miles or several kilometers away from the border of Turkey was where Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the leader of the Islamic State, was hiding. Now, there are various agreements with regard to this territory between Russia, the Islamic Republic of Iran, and the Turkish government. But at the same time, there is no consensus about this territory, and the territory is currently controlled by Tahrir al-Sham, a jihadist group that calls for, once again, establishing all of Syria and Iraq, the same way pretty much like the Islamic State has called to do. Why is the international community not vying to make a difference and allowing only the Astana conversation, of course, that it's still operating with regard to trying and resolve this the conflict in Syria, as the only means to end an Islamist problem?
There is an old military joke regarding an infantry squad training for a week, and then finally, when weekend comes, the sergeant calls them in and tells them, okay, guys, you have 10 minutes to change socks. When they start going towards their sex, he says, no, with each other. Mm. The all of these rebels and terrorists were in different parts of Syria, and they were mopped under the carpet in Idlib. They were all sucked, sometimes bust, into one area, which was left for the end. This was the Russian and Syrian game plan to let them escape other places, get Assad control over the other areas, and then get Idlib. So now we are approaching the Battle of Idlib. And during this battle, all of these terrorists will either be killed or captured. There are hundreds of thousands of civilians there. Also families, those of the fighters, of terrorists. Now, Bashar Assad and before him, his father, Hafez Assad, were always against Muslim extremists because they were the most dangerous adversary. Hafez Assad killed 20,000 or so in Hama in 1982. It doesn't make the Assad dynasty a benefactor or a just one of the just of the world. It just means that they, the Alawites, who allied themselves with the Shiites, the Alawites being a minority in Syria, were fighting Sunni extremists long ago. So they are now allied with the Russians and others, and perhaps with the Iranians who are Shiites, against these terrorists. But they can also shift alliances, as they did many times during this war. Nothing is permanent in what is happening there. One day, you see the Americans with the Kurds. The next day, the Americans are letting the Turks get the better of the Kurds. Then they, all of a sudden, the Turks who were against Assad are his allies for a day. There is an old saying that you cannot buy a Syrian. You can also rent him by the hour.
Mr. Ben Menachem, how do you perceive this?
I think that seriously, the problem is, you asked before about what should be said to the
Mark
defense
Esper.
Minister, to Mark Esper. I think that the root of the problem is the Muslim Brotherhood. And President Trump had the plan to, from the beginning, even before he was elected, to take care of this movement of Muslim Brotherhood because and to put sanction on them, to declare them as a terror organization, because as we know, this is the source of Al-Qaeda, the source of Daesh, the source of Hizb al-Tahrir, all these Hamas, Islamic Jihad, all of these organizations, they support jihad and support caliphate, Islamic State. So this is the source of the problem, this movement. And I think a year ago it was there was some progress about it in announcing them as a terror organization in the United States. And then there were many states and the people involved, Qatar, made a lot of public relations among the administration to prevent, they succeeded to prevent this thing. But now it's time to declare them as a terror organization and put sanctions on them. And once the Americans will do that, maybe other countries will do that. And this is very important in order to try and stop and to use this momentum of killing Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi and start going to the roots of the problem.
Not to forget, of course, that the Muslim Brotherhood's headquarters is in London, and a lot of their supporters are within Western European and American parliaments
and
Congress even.
And Britain is against outlawing them.
Yeah.
This is a big problem, but also we have to remember that
Turkey
and Erdogan, he sees himself as one of the big leaders of the Muslim Brotherhood.
The irony that the only, or one of the only countries in the world that banned the Muslim Brotherhood is Egypt from all countries. Dr. Rhode, I would like to focus once more on Syria. To what degree is the United States in control, considering the fact that it has now a residual force? Secretary Esper called it a mechanized force. In order to protect oil infrastructure from falling into the hands of the Islamic State, potentially also, even though not naming the proxies of the Islamic Republic of Iran and others in the region, and also considering the fact that the Russians are now increasing their presence in northern Syria as well. They have deployed additional forces to fulfill their pledge to the Turks of joint patrols along the border. It's a small corridor of about 6.2 miles or 10 kilometers. To what degree do you see the Americans still controlling the situation, even though they're not really there?
Well, there's no power in the world like the United States. And if America chooses, it can pretty much do anything. There may be a more sophisticated policy here. And it is one, frankly, that Prime Minister Netanyahu has followed for Syria, which is we love everybody. We don't support anybody. We want everybody to fight each other. And they're very good at that. And the difference between, for example, Jewish culture and what you see in the Muslim world is when they have enemies or when they fight, they kill. And as long, I think it was Napoleon, I'm not going to get this exactly right, who said, when I see my enemies fighting, I should just look back and enjoy. And if I were today advising the President of the United States, what I would say is it's time for us to help everybody win. Because if everybody wins, we just sit back and watch. And as I mentioned previously, there are these Muslims in the world who understand what the situation is, that they're in real trouble. And the only way they can open their mouths and not be murdered by all these what we call extremists is if the extremists die. Now, many years ago, when ISIS was created, incidentally, by the way, also with Iranian help, even though it's Shiite, I was asked on a leftist TV show in Israel what to do. And my answer is you must eradicate them. But at the same time as you eradicate them, you should, you know, make sure that everybody is fighting everybody else. And then you don't have to do much. America says now that it's going to ensure the oil fields. I think that's great. How they're going to handle that, I don't know. But I would only say that if anybody wants to understand Trump's policy, and you can see it looks like he's all over the place, Trump wrote a book called The Art of the Deal, and he explains how he negotiates. And his whole goal is that the enemy, his enemy or his opponent, not know exactly where he stands. He'll say this one day, he'll say this the next. I would only argue that that is what is going on here, with the exception of one thing. On Iran, what he is doing is simply putting, making a pincer movement around the place. The idea of withdrawing, first of all, from the Kurdish areas in the north, the Iranians had no troops up in that area on the Turkish border. But then, again, the Erdogan and Khomeini are best of friends until they're not. And all of a sudden you have troops, Turkish troops on the border and Iranian troops on the border. Iranians need that, those troops in other places. The Iranians basically had the whole Kurdish question pretty much under control. They don't now. And the answer is all around simply to squeeze them. And that seems to be, again, certainly I don't speak with President Trump, but that seems to be the general policy. Squeeze Iran in the long run. That's what we want.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Oren, I'd like to actually focus on the current shift. We're talking, of course, about the need to preserve somewhat of a control over Syria in one way or another. To what degree do you believe that the United States would indeed sit back, as Dr. Rhodes says, and watch the things play out while pulling the strings, or as President Trump, President Obama said at the time, pull or, you know, lead from behind?
Well, Trump is calling the shots. Even his military was not in the loop when he arranged with Erdogan to pull out of the Kurdish area. The chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General Milley, was astounded to hear about it via a tweet. So we have to speak about the Trumpian policy.
Even though there were reports specifically about Milley advising Trump to make this maneuver.
No, his Israeli counterpart called him up and found that he was as astounded as the Israeli general. But I'm only mentioning that because we have to try and decipher what Donald Trump personally thinks, because this is American policy. And what he has said is that the American national interest right now in Syria has to do with the oil fields and with Atanf. Why Atanf in the south? Because this is the tri-border area, Israel, Jordan, and Syria. And the American interest is for that particular area to be guarded by Americans. There is also another one, the Abu Kamal passageway between Iraq and Syria, because if this is open for the Iranian Quds force, we will see missiles and rockets and troops going through.
It's open.
We're drawing near to the end of the program, so I'd like to give each and every one of you a closing statement. Mr. Ben Menachem, we'll start with you.
The concerning Tanef and Abu Kamal, I think this is the danger for Israel. Tanef, the Americans, for the meanwhile, are staying there, and this is very important. But Abu Kamal is already officially opened, and Qasem Soleimani, General Qasem Soleimani, is building a big compound there, to...
Some kilometers north from Abu Kamal,
yes,
there is a different...
this is the area, but this is going to be the main route of the supply of the accurate missiles and the rockets from Iran to Syria and then to Hezbollah in Lebanon. And this is the real danger for Israel. We have to stop that, and we need the help of the Americans. We cannot do this alone. The problem also, another aspect that we didn't talk about, is all the question of elections. So the presidency in the United States, and President Trump is very affected by it, and the impeachment, of course, and he's taking all these things in considerations when he makes these important decisions about Syria, about Iran.
Well, we'll have to discuss this in a different program, Dr. Rhode.
I think Iran is the long run the key to understanding what President Trump wants, or what his Iran is the bottom line. Now, Iran all of a sudden has to worry about its corridor through the Mediterranean. In Iraq, the Iranian-backed government of Iraq, which is basically Shiite, you have all over Iraq and the Shiite areas, Shiite revolts, including in Najaf and Karbala, which are the Shiite Vatican. That's the central, it's more important to Shiites, frankly, than Mecca. They don't say it, but they act that way. That's basically, they're in trouble. Number two is Lebanon. These riots that are going on in Lebanon, you know, from conversations with people that are in Beirut right now, Nasrallah, who's nothing more than an Iranian agent, is now shooting fellow Shiites. Iran is losing. Our job is to encourage that in any way we can. R means the United States and Israel.
Mr. Owen?
There is a card up Israel's sleeve, and that is the Russian wish to keep Bashar Assad in power. And they know that if Israel finds it in its interest, it will topple Assad. This makes for an arrangement between Israel and Russia.
Well, this is all the time that we have for today. I'd like to thank Mr. Ben Menachem, Mr. Oren, and Dr. Rhodes for being here today. I'd like to thank our viewers as well, and we will see you next time.
You just watched TV7 Jerusalem Studio. We encourage you to pray for the challenges raised in today's program. If you were blessed by our production, please consider supporting TV7 Israel. The details of our respective bank accounts for donations from Europe and the United States appear on the screen. Your generosity allows us to continue to serve God's calling, to broadcast content that truly matters through TV7 Israel from Jerusalem.